to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him, in his presence daily live. I surrender all, I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all.
Dear friends, we are gathered around this altar of the Lord on this Saturday, the eve of the Lord's Day, the first day of the week for our dear Father John. All over the world, it's the feast of Christ the King. All over the world today, in all of our parishes, the Holy Spirit invites us to celebrate World Youth Day. So we open our hearts to God's love and grace for us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. And we acknowledge the presence of God's Spirit. We are unworthy, for which we ask for his forgiveness, his mercy. As we cry out, I confess to Almighty God what I failed to do, my fault through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary ever Virgin, Lord have mercy. Christ have mercy. Lord have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. O God, who are mercy for sinners and the happiness of your saints, give, we pray, to your servant, our dear Father John Gnanapiragasam, for whom we perform the fraternal office of burial, a share with your chosen ones in the blessedness you give, so that on the day of the resurrection, freed from the bonds of mortality, he may come before your face. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
silver and gold. And its very wealthy temple containing golden armor, breastplates, and weapons left there by Alexander, son of Philip, the king of Macedon, the first to reign over the Greeks. He therefore went and attempted to take the city and pillage it, but without success, since the citizens learned of his intention and offered him a stiff resistance. Whereupon he turned about and retreated, disconsolate, in the direction of Babylon. But while he was still in Persia, news reached him that the armies that had invaded the land of Judah had been defeated, and that Lysias in particular had advanced in massive strength, only to be forced to turn and flee before the Jews. This had been strengthened by the acquisition of arms, supplies, and abundant spoils from the armies they had cut into pieces. They had overthrown the abomination he had erected over the altar in Jerusalem, and had encircled the sanctuary with high walls as in the past, and had fortified Bethzer, one of his cities. When the king heard this news, he was amazed and profoundly shaken. He threw himself on his bed and fell into a lethargy from acute disappointment, because things had not turned out for him as he had planned. And there he remained for many days, subject to deep and recurrent fits of melancholy, until he understood that he was dying. Then summoning all of his friends, he said to them, "Sleep awaits my eyes, and my heart is cowed by anxiety. I have been asking myself how I could have come to such a pitch of distress. So great a flood as that which now engulfs me. I, who was so generous and well-loved in my heyday. But now I remember the wrong I did in Jerusalem when I seized all the vessels of silver and gold there and ordered the extermination of the inhabitants of Judah for no reason at all. This, I am convinced, is why these misfortunes have overtaken me, and why I am dying of melancholy in a foreign land." The word of the Lord.
The responsorial psalm is, "I will rejoice in your saving help, O Lord."
I will rejoice in your saving help, O Lord.
I will praise you, Lord, with all my heart. I will recount all your wonders. I will rejoice in you and be glad, and sing psalms to your name, O Most High. Response:
I will rejoice in your saving help, O Lord.
See how my enemies turn back, how they stumble and perish before you. You have checked the nations, destroyed the wicked. You have wiped out their names forever and ever. Response: I will rejoice in your saving help. The nations' feet have been caught in the snares they laid. For the needy shall not always be forgotten, nor the hopes of the poor be in vain. Response: I will rejoice in your saving help. Alleluia.
Alleluia. Alleluia.
Our Savior Christ. Christ, Jesus abolished death and he has proclaimed life through the good news.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Some Sadducees, those who say that there is no resurrection, approached Jesus and put this question to him, "Master, we have it from Moses in writing that if a man's married brother dies childless, the man must marry the widow to raise up children for his brother. Well then, there were seven brothers. The first, having married a wife, died childless. The second, and then the third, married the widow. And the same with all seven. They died leaving no children. Finally, the woman herself died. Now, at the resurrection, to which of them will she be wife, since she had been married to all seven?" Jesus replied, "The children of this world take wives and husbands, but those who are judged worthy of a place in the other world and in the resurrection from the dead do not marry, because they can no longer die. For they are the same as the angels, and being children of the resurrection, they are sons of God. And Moses himself implies that the dead rise again. In the passage about the bush, where he calls the Lord, God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Now God, he is God, not of the dead, but of the living. For to him all peoples are in fact alive." Some scribes then spoke up. "Well put, Master," they said, because they would not dare to ask him any more questions. The Gospel of the Lord. Dear friends, brothers and sisters in Christ, firstly to acknowledge the parish media ministry of our young people who are helping in this live streaming so that so many more at home and perhaps all over the world who know Father John could also be part of this celebration, so that through this gift of the media, we could help them come closer to this place and there grieve, mourn, and seek a good way of saying farewell. For this past 1.5 years, everything has been stripped off from us. Everything has been taken away from us. And you know it, in this MCO, literally everything has been taken away from us. The Sunday Eucharist, physically in church, visiting churches, the sacraments, marriages, baptisms, yeah, coming to church, everything has been stripped away from us. Confessions, even funerals. Stripped away from us in the sense that if someone, our loved one, passed away, or a natural death maybe, or sickness, we were limited to just the family members of maybe 20. Yeah? And if that individual, our loved one, passed away of COVID, there was no way for us, for there is no way for us to even bid our farewell. As soon as a member of the family goes in to the mortuary or whatever, with all of the PPP to identify the body, the only thing some can do is to click a photograph or two. We can't say our goodbyes, give our kiss or whatever. And not only that, when we get to the cemetery, we are about 70 feet away. Nobody is allowed to go near. Only the next day. Literally, we have been stripped of everything of the church that we love and have lived all these years. And yet, in all of this being stripped away, only one thing remains. Only one thing remained with all of us. Our relationship with God, our relationship with Jesus. And so in this MCO, the only other contact that we would have is through the online masses. Oh, I'm so jealous in some way, envious that you have young people helping out with media. Next door in Nilai, I used to have one or two of them help me with this. And then when the MCO got deeper, they all stayed away. And so I was doing it all by myself. I would set up the camera before the altar, switch it on, click in, and then come to the other side and celebrate Mass. Saying to myself, I want to celebrate this Mass in thanksgiving to Jesus. I'm saying this because even now, when we would have this wake in this limited number, we too are suffering the same anguish and pain as family members of not being able to be as a community. Yeah? We are not looking for crowds. We are not looking for a big gathering. And we are making count of the number of people who have passed by to say farewell to Father. But in this wake and through the readings of this day, we are coming to this realization more and more. What is my faith? What is my relationship with Jesus? When everything else has been taken away, what is my faith? Each one of us has been given this grace in this pandemic to reflect on this. King Antiochus did the same in his time when he went through that pain and suffering. He came to the end saying, I realize because this suffering is because of what I did to the temple. To the temple of the Lord. My dear brothers and sisters, in this time of the pandemic, we continue to journey as church. And we need to keep asking of ourselves this question over and over and over again. Each one of us, ask that question in our relationship with Jesus. So that purified, we can get to know Him more. For you and for me, there is a new aspect to being church. So often it's being said this whole time or episode of becoming a new church. Not another church, but a new church. A new church that goes deeper into one's heart, every one of us, to ask this question, the intensity of my love and of my relationship with Jesus. I will rejoice in your saving help, O Lord. And they realize from the psalmist that it is this personal relationship with Jesus, or as Father John would so often say in his reflections, not what I do for God, but what God in his love is doing for me. To realize what God has been doing for me. And the psalmist is saying today, and helping us say today, I will rejoice in your saving help, O Lord, with all my heart, in one heart. And every one of us here have had some contact with Father. There are so many of you who are at home and unable to come for whatever reasons, age, distance, fear. With all my heart, we say, thank you, God. The psalmist is continuing, I will recount all your wonders. I'm sure maybe perhaps some of us have come from other parishes and we had had contact with Father John. And we are recalling all those wonderful things that we have come to know of the Lord through him and because of him. Recounting all his wonders with thanksgiving in our hearts. I will rejoice and be glad. Rejoice and be glad to you, God our Father, for the wonderful gift of his love and his life. I will thank you and I will praise you. See how my enemies, they stumble and perish before you. You have destroyed the wicked. You have wiped out your name. We acknowledge that through the service that John, our dear Father John, has given to the church, and somehow we have received, he has helped us. He has helped us be separated from the forces of evil. I will rejoice in your saving help. Asking these questions, as did so many people of old, and all of us here this tonight, to come to this response of thanksgiving and gratitude. That's the first part of looking to what God's word is saying. The second part that I want to share with all of you is this. All over the world today, it's World Youth Day. Dioceses have been asked to celebrate World Youth Day in their respective parishes. And so the Pope, inspired by the Spirit, is saying to us, for us in this message, arise, testify joyfully that Christ is alive. So when we are sharing this to our young people, we are also wanting to listen to this as church. Arise, testify joyfully that Christ is alive. He's going on to say, and reflect on this, arise, testify joyfully that Christ is alive, based on the conversion of Saint Paul. And so to all of our young people who are participating with us at Mass today online, and to the number who are here this evening, and all of us as parishioners, he's saying to us, in Jesus' name, I ask you, arise, testify that you too were blind and encountered the light. Testify this in this time of the pandemic. Don't go back to the moaning and groaning of old. Oh, we did not have. Oh, we did not have this, and we could not do this, and we could not do that. But he said, coming out of all this, testify joyfully that Christ is alive. You too have seen God's goodness and beauty in yourself, in others, in the communion of the church, where all lowliness is overcome. We have seen this. We have seen this. Yes, we agree. We know that it has been really difficult for all of us. As much as we have said and we have been saying, it has also been a wonderful time. Families meeting up together in MCO, all through WhatsApp. Setting a certain time to say, we will all chit-chat on WhatsApp with Grandma, Grandpa. Yep. For those who are within a certain area, visiting. Right? Testify to this. Don't just sulk in, poor me. Arise, testify to the love and respect that it is possible to instill in human relationships, in the life of our families, in the dialogue between parents and children, between the young and the elderly. Often I hear this being said, Father, I had so much of time during this pandemic to connect with family. If not for this pandemic, I would have been out somewhere, jumping and running from one place to another. Though not physically, but somehow through WhatsApp, I have been able to contact, be in touch. So he's saying, testify to this. Don't sulk in the poor me, and I'm going through tough times. He continued, testify to the new way of looking at things that enable us to view creation with eyes brimming with wonder. That makes us see the earth as our common home and gives you the courage to promote integral ecology. Testify to this. A new way of looking at things and looking at yourself. Of how we have become to appreciate people even more. Family. Church. Then he says, testify that lives of failure can be rebuilt, that persons spiritually dead can rise again, that hearts overwhelmed by sorrow can rediscover hope, that we do not no longer say, what a poor thing that only 70 of us are allowed at a time, but that our Christian hope will say to us, there is something wonderful even in this. It's not about the numbers, but it is about an opportunity to connect with God in this time of the passing of Father John. He says then, testify joyfully that Christ is alive by spreading his message of love and salvation among your contemporaries, at school, in the university, at work, in the digital world, everywhere. Yep. Testify to this joyfully. And not just be spending hours lying in bed or in the morning to be scanning the face of our phones, to looking at all the WhatsApp messages. Yeah, share and testify this message that Jesus has done wonders for us. He's saying to us, all over the world, we see great numbers of individuals, including young people, helping to save lives. Helping to save lives. So many young people have been touched by the life of this servant. And you know what it is. Testify to this. Today God is saying to us on World Youth Day, arise. Because God is helping us prepare for new times and a new page. He ends by quoting Saint Therese, like so many other saints, love to say that humility is truth. That humility is truth. This man, our beloved priest friend, brother, whom you two have come to know and love, had expressed all of this presence of God in what he had shared with us on Thursday morning at our priest clergy. Yeah? He had raised his hands up at question time and he had intervened and said something. he said, I want question number 4 of the 10 themes. Yeah, and the theme is celebration. He referred us to that and said, there are three parts to it. For all those 10 themes, there are three parts. And then he referred us to the third part. And he quoted us this. The third part says, what is the Spirit asking of us? Of us. And so he continued, it would be better to ask, what is the call of the Spirit? Then he went on to share with us that different conferences around the world express it differently. Then he said, I particularly like what was shared by the bishops of Australia. That is, recall, reflect, and respond. We will definitely see, that is Father John, all right. Yeah? Then he went on to say that the text of the four parts speaks about gathering the fruits. But he says, it is not so much the gathering of the fruits as in our sharing, the response, our response to what the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, is calling of us. What is the Holy Spirit calling of us? And so as I was recalling that section of what he had shared, which is celebration, I was saying to myself, how apt he chose in the second part of the day, he chose to join that group. The topic of the synodal theme, celebration. And I'm saying, how typical of Father John. That's him, all right. Celebration, not a celebrity, you know, though he was. But he was always a celebration of the mystery of Christ. Those of you who have celebrated masses with him, seen him pray, yeah? The way he holds the gestures of his hands in prayer. Let us pray. The way he stretches his hands open wide. The way he would greet us in the dialogue, the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Yeah? No, you all are not responding. Eh? Hello, I know he has passed away, but our Christian faith says, celebrate this love. Yeah? Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. And I'm sure some of you are saying, Father John, whenever he comes, he has oil lamps all over the altar, you know, and the tabernacle. And then some of us will also say, Father John puts a lot of incense around the altar. I can't take it. I'm sure some of you have said that. But you know what? For him, it was not about putting all these things there. It was his whole relationship with Jesus that he expressed in that reverential celebration of the Eucharist. And so many of you will testify to this, that when he prays, it's so beautiful. Yeah? And that's what Jesus is calling all of us to. A personal relationship with Jesus, with him, of faith, to celebrate and express this in our lives, in community. And this is what we are about as church. The last part of the homily is this. To all of our young people, and to all of us here today. Right? Father John, certainly encourage all of us to make that effort to go and be involved with the synodal process that is going on in the church. Yeah? The synodal process that has been asked of the Holy Spirit, not of Pope Francis, not of Pope Francis, not of our bishops, not of our parish priests, but of the Holy Spirit. To open our hearts and talk to each other, to open our hearts and listen. So make an effort, dear parishioners, everyone online. If you have not heard about this pre-synodal process in your parish, ask your priests, ask your leaders, when are we going to have this? When can I get involved in this? Because in those 10 themes, journeying together, celebration, listening, asking questions, ecumenism, we are being purified. Purified of our relationship with Jesus. While John, in expressing his faith in his life, lived it to the best as he could. He's giving us an example of how we too should build this relationship with Jesus, that personal relationship with Jesus. And we're all doing it in so many ways. Wonderful, you know. Celebrate it in community, in our church, parish. Live it in our daily lives, not just around the altar, but out in our families, out in the world. And it's an invitation for all of us, parishioners, priests, bishop, all of us, so that by this, we too will give testimony that God is alive, that through this, we long to be with you, God, forever. And when you call us on that day, come, we will be ready to go. Amen. Let's spend a few quiet moments in thanksgiving. Let's take all of this then to the altar in bread and wine.
We shall take the hymn on page 167 on the pattern.
On the pattern with the host, I offer up my lowly heart. All my life, my deeds, my thoughts, thine shall be as mine thou art. Chalice, let me be a drop of water mingled there, lost, O Jesus, in thy love, thy great sacrifice I share. All today and every day, O Jesus, let me live in thee, so that I no longer live, but that thou mayst live through me.
Pray, dear friends, that this our sacrifice, yours and mine, may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that through these holy mysteries, Father John Gnanapiragasam, your servant and priest, may behold with clarity forever what he faithfully ministered here through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father. We give you thanks for the gift of your beloved Son, Jesus. In his life, death, and resurrection, he has brought us back to you. He has opened in our hearts and in our lives a way to proclaim your love, your mercy. And you have done this for us in so many ways. All through our life's journey, you have done this for us in the example of your servant, our beloved Father John. And so in the company of the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy, we sing to your glory. Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. This is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and, once more giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you.
Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, and Julian our Bishop, and all the clergy.
Remember your servant, Father John Gnanapiragasam, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he, who was united with your Son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection.
Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. As Jesus taught us, so we have the courage to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray you, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope, the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Lamb of God,
you take away the sins of the world,
have mercy on us.
Lamb of God,
you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. To those of you who are participating at Mass online, come, look to Jesus. And we enter into this time of spiritual communion. Jesus, I thank you for this opportunity to be here before you at the altar, though not physically, but spiritually through the gift of this live streaming. I ask you, O Jesus, take me to yourself in mind, body, and spirit, and let me enter into spiritual communion with you. Touch me, that I may touch you. Embrace me with your love, for I know that when you embrace me, I will be whole in mind, body, and spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Together, all those of you who are at home, the body of Christ. Let us pray. Having received the sacrament of salvation, we implore your kindness, O God, for Father John Gnanapiragasam, your servant and priest, that as you made him a steward of your mysteries on earth, so you may bring him to be nourished by their truth and reality as unveiled in heaven through Christ our Lord. For the departed members of our families, the forgotten souls, for the souls of Father John Yana, for the soul of Father Florimon, come, eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord. May their soul and the souls of all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless us. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit descend upon us and remain with us forever and ever. Go and announce the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I'll take the final hymn on page 162, Mother Dearest, Mother Fairest. Mother dearest, Mother fairest, help of all who call on thee. Virgin purest, brightest, rarest, help us, help, we cry to thee. Mary, help us, help, we pray. Mary, help us, help, we pray. Help us in all care and sorrow. Mary, help us, help, we pray.